I trust you can handle this contraption, Q.
It goes by hot air.
Oh, then you can.
Welcome to Trimming the Movie Fat, the podcast where we trim films from franchises that don't belong. I'm Stephen Nicholson.
And I'm Paul Nicholson.
And welcome back to the world of James Bond for the concluding part of our look at Roger Moore's tenure as 007. Which movies will survive being kicked off a cliff face by Sir Roger? The more stripped back For Your Eyes Only, the India visiting Octopussy, Moore's swan song A View to a Kill. Keep listening to find out. We'll also share some Bond movie facts, provide an overview of each movie, share our thoughts on each, and rank all seven Sir Roger Moore Bond movies. Returning to the submarine disguised as an iceberg are our two guests, Paul and Davie Melon. Welcome back, chaps. So guys, episode 2. If you guys only Octopussy and A View to a Kill, before we get to it, let's maybe share what our favourite scene is from those movies. So, Paul, brother Paul, I'll maybe start with you.
Roger and Grace Jones, when he goes, I'm waiting for you to take care of me personally, maybe, because it's so bad. It's so bad, it's good. So probably that bit, because I know he had a good relationship with Grace Jones, so. Yeah, probably say that, but when he comes back, when he jumps back, comes back from the stables and he's pretending that he's been there all the time. Yeah. So
it's when you find out what Grace Jones was wearing underneath her dressing gown.
Yes, she was, yes.
She was wearing a how can we put it? She was wearing an appendage.
Yes.
So Sir Roger got quite a big shock when that robe came off.
So a prosthetic leg by any chance, was it?
Yeah, you could call it that.
Third leg, I know. Okay, thank you, Paul. I think for mine, it would be Fear Eyes Only, and I'm a big fan of the part where Melina and Bond are dragged under the water, you know, and they're trying to get them, obviously drown them or get eaten by the sharks. That's a really good dramatic scene. So I think that's probably it for me. Paul, what about you?
And Bond and Octopus is sliding down the banister and he's chewing up all the baddies and he sees the ornament at the end and he shoots that off before he does himself an injury.
Yeah, that's a view to a kill. Paul, it's not a view to a kill. No, it's not. It's Octopussy. Sorry, I stand corrected. Keep that in. Well, quite you balls that up, Paul. Thunderball, yeah, he would have hurt his thunderballs. Davie, what about you?
Which one has the bus chase scene?
Live and Let Die?
That's Live and Let Die.
Right, not that one. So it's the tuk-tuk chase in Octopussy.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
When he's saved from death by the big pile of money and he just chucks it away.
Good for hard currency.
Hard currency, yeah. Is that where Rupees. Is that the part where he makes it? No. I think it's before that, doesn't he? When he's handing out the cash, he makes his rather.
Yes. that's one of my famous lines. That'll keep you in curry for a few weeks.
It's like
really 1983, yes.
Yeah, that one, that particular line hasn't aged too well, has it? Stereotyping, yeah. Okay, thanks for that, guys. And on to some movie facts then. So I'll maybe kick us off with this. that the biggest box office flop of all time is 2012's John Carter. So the budget on that was over $260 million US, and it grossed only $284 million. So I think when you factor in promotion and all that, wonderful things, it lost between, it's estimated, $133 to $236 million. Ouch. That's mine. Davey, what's your movie fact?
So in Rocky IV, the one with Dolph Lundgren, Sylvester Stallone wanted to make sure that the boxing scenes like real out, like they'd been done properly. So he got Dolph Lundgren to actually hit him. And a punch, one particular punch to the chest left Stallone in the intensive care for 9 days.
Well, Lundgren does look like he would do you some harm, let's be honest. Man machine. Paul, what about you?
I was just doing a quick search here on movie facts, and some of the velociraptor noises in Jurassic Park are actually tortoises mating.
Really?
Yeah.
I've got a video of tortoises mating, so I can
confirm that.
Confirm that. If you've watched my recent Africa video at the very end.
Well, talking of
specialist there, David, wasn't it?
Special effects there. talking of Jurassic Park and such like, I cannot recommend highly enough the recent documentary that came out on Industrial Light and Magic that's on Disney Plus. 6 episodes. I forget the name of it, but whatever it's called. But anyway, it's about ILM, and it just charts the start of ILM, to make the original Star Wars.
ILM, that's right. Yeah.
And how they've kind of progressed over the years. It is brilliant. So if you're interested in movie effects and how they've changed over the years, fabulous. So definitely recommend that. And there is velociraptors and there is dinosaur sounds in it. So, Brother Paul.
So, apparently Jack Nicholson pulled a real gun out in The Departed on Leonardo DiCaprio. The reason why he thought the scene wasn't intense enough initially, so he pulled out a real gun to get that intensity.
Where did he get the gun from?
Jack Nicholson.
He's learning from the Alec Baldwin School of Realism there.
Huh? Yes, Alec Baldwin.
Right, okay. That's a bit dubious. Okay, let's move on to our Bond facts. Our Bond fact from it doesn't have to be from the 1980s, but ideally it is. And I'll kick us off with one that I found out about. For A View to a Kill, which was Sir Roger's final Bond movie, it was Priscilla Presley who was originally going to be cast as the female lead as Stacey Sutton, but she had to be replaced by Tanya Roberts because of her contract with the TV show Dallas. So we could have, mind you, that might have meant we'd never have got her in The Naked Gun. What's the name of her character in it again? He calls her Doll Face, doesn't he? Doll Face.
What's her name again?
How many times I've seen it as well? I can't remember.
Oh, yeah. Same here.
Jessica something, is it now?
Rabbit.
Fletcher.
I'm going to have to IMDb it. Or we'll never get past that for the rest of the show. Freudian slip type in that there. Naked Fun.
It's Jane Spencer.
Is it really?
Jane Spencer.
Yeah, when you think about Jane, yeah.
Right.
Really?
Where I'm from.
Jane. The Spencer part, though. No. Never have got that.
Maybe related to Frank.
Anyway, that was mine. Brother Paul, do you have a Bond fact?
Yeah, it's quite interesting, actually. I didn't realise this. Quite appropriate to what we're doing now. Despite starring in 7 Bond films, Roger Moore actually suffers from hoplophobia, a fear of firearms.
That kind of makes sense, because you notice whenever he fires a gun in any of the Bond movies, he always kind of blinks.
Doesn't like it, yeah.
Yeah, that would make sense. I didn't know that.
Neither did I, until 10 minutes ago.
I like your research.
My preparation.
Preparation.
Prior preparation prevents poor performance.
Yeah.
Easy. Davie?
So, this is probably a wee bit later on, but someone did a count of the number of drinks that Daniel Craig has in Casino Royale, and over the course of the movie, he drinks 26 bevvies.
26?
And he's still driving his car after the casino.
Probably most of them are at the casino.
That's some serious shit there.
26 beverages, that's serious, yeah.
Much would that have cost as well, I wonder?
No?
Particularly in London, Paul. Is...
It cost me nearly £7 for a bottle of smoothie in a pub, a small bottle, so yeah.
So, Paul, what's your fact?
Well, Roger Moore holds the record as both the oldest debuting Bond, age 45, in his first Bond movie, Live and Let Die, and the oldest Bond ever, age 57. In his final appearance as Bond in A View to a Kill. And I think he looks his age in A View to a Kill, to be honest.
Yeah, very much so. Because Daniel Craig was, what, 55 by the end of his run, is that right?
I think he's a wee bit younger, is he?
Not sure.
Not much, though. I think maybe 53, maybe.
But that's what's always quite ironic, that Roger Moore took over playing Bond at 45, and Moore, you know, is older than Connery, but he looked younger than Connery.
Definitely in Live and Let Die, yeah.
Yeah, big time. Okay, well, thank you for that, gentlemen.
Daniel Craig's 54 now, so he would have been 51, 52, and he did No Time to Die, obviously, because of the pandemic and stuff.
Well, it's a world of difference, just like physically, comparing Daniel Craig at that age to Roger Moore.
Yeah. I suppose there's still 5 years, though, from... Yeah.
I suppose it's just the physicality, isn't it? You'd still, even at 51, 52, you'd still say that the shape Daniel Craig's in, he'd be able to handle himself.
Yeah.
Whereas Roger Moore, by the end, you're wondering if he could even step onto the bus with his bus pass.
Yeah. Even
without injuring himself. Yeah, I know. So the three films we're talking about today are from Roger Moore's 80s tenure as Bond. For Your Eyes Only, from 1981, and directed by John Glenn. Octopussy, from 1983, and again directed by John Glenn. And A View to a Kill, from 1985, and you guessed it, directed by John Glenn.
Five days ago, our spy ship, St. George's, sank in the Ionian Sea.
He wants me out of the way. Using a British agent to do his dirty work for him.
My name is Bond. James Bond.
The West is decadent and divided.
You know what this is?
₹100,000.
Move! And it doesn't matter a damn to you, I suppose, if thousands of innocent people will be killed in that accident of yours.
Thank you. Welcome, sir. I'm Jenny Flex.
Of course you are.
You lost, 007.
I propose to end the domination of Silicon Valley. Intuitive improvisation is the secret of genius.
There's never a cab when you want one. Camo Khan has rolled his lucky dice and won again. So it sounds like a good time to start delving into these three movies.
For your eyes only. It's Roger Moore as Ian Fleming's James Bond 007.
Days ago, our spy ship was sunk in the Ionian Sea. She was equipped with ATAC.
Have we begun a salvage operation?
We asked Sir Timothy Havelock to secretly locate the wreck. He and his wife were killed by Hector Gonzalez. Police were able to identify Gonzalez by Melina, Sir Havelock's daughter.
Explosive. Exclusive.
Well, I trust you, Helcar.
For your amazement, this bond is for you.
Oh, by the way, we haven't been properly introduced, Melina. My name is Bond. James Bond.
Mr. Bond, you have shot your last bolt.
We're not dead yet.
Good afternoon, Mr. Bond. You are now flying under remote control. Goodbye, Mr. Bond.
I'm the Countess Liesel von Schloch.
Why not come in for a bite?
For your eyes only can see me through the night.
This bond is for your eyes only. No one comes close to 007. When 007 comes close to you,
Roger Moore, 007 for the fifth time and fit as a fiddle. How do you do it, dare I ask?
I play the fiddle.
Roger, this James Bond a little bit different. The characters seem more realistic, even the baddies, and there isn't the gadgetry, the stunt work's terrific. Have you tried in any way to tailor your character as Bond to suit that formula?
No, I just wander through saying my name is Bond, James Bond. Sometimes I say it's Brooke, but most of the time it's James. I'm delighted with this one, the fact that the villains are more recognisable as ordinary human beings. They don't want to build empires in space or under the ocean.
You have been, I know it's going back in history a little bit, you've been Ivanhoe and The Saint and The Persuaders. Is there, and your recent films as well have been very much action film. Is there a danger of being typed as a sort of an action man character in the film world?
Do you know what the royalties are from being an action man?
I don't know. You care to tell us? Perhaps you better not.
Well, I don't know. When I was a kid, boys didn't play with dolls. We had trains and Meccano sets. But today they all have action men. And if that's what they're buying, you know, I'm an action man.
Right. But you're an actor as well.
Well, I have an equity card that says so.
This is a very exciting film with some of the best chases I've seen since, 3 weeks ago, Raiders of the Lost Ark. Also, the villains in this film are quite believable characters, not silly cartoon figures as in the last few Bond pictures. Good chases, credible villains, a beautiful woman. That's more than enough for me to recommend For Your Eyes Only.
Well, I liked it too, and I would recommend it too, but I did not enjoy it nearly as much as you did in terms of going all the way back to movies like Dr. No and From Russia With Love. Those were the real classics as far as I'm concerned. And this movie, I don't know, maybe it's because there have been too many Bond pictures, but I felt as if I'd seen many of these ingredients before in other movies, like the ski chase and the underwater stuff.
Well, those things have been done, but I think the point that I'm trying to make is the following. I thought when the beginning Bond pictures, everybody was out to try and prove something. Mm-hmm. They were inventing a genre, mm-hmm. as it were. And I thought they did a very good job. Then, with Roger Moore, I think everybody got overconfident, and they mm-hmm. thought they could put in any star and do anything and be sloppy and throw in a lot of commercial plugs and it would still sell mm-hmm. all around the world, which it did. Now, I think with this film, I detect a change. I think that somebody's really trying here to move a picture along, move it, be a little rougher, a little more with a believable picture, rather than these silly laugh-at-the-villain films.
I'll tell you, Gene, the last thing I'm looking for in a James Bond picture is believability. And I really like the villains that they had in some of the previous pictures who were totally creations of fantasy.
No, but what I'm talking about, the two pictures you named, Dr. No and From Russia With Love, are a little rough. Fine, mm-hmm. but those were very exciting, and they were a little harder, a little tougher, mm-hmm. and that's what I liked about them.
Well, I think you're looking for the right things in the Bond pictures, but I don't think I found those things in this picture.
And two strong yes votes for the latest James Bond film, For Your Eyes Only. It has one great chase scene after another.
So For Your Eyes Only was released in 1981. Its director was John Glenn, who had previously worked as an editor and second unit director on previous Bond movies. The plot? Well, when a British ship is sunk in foreign waters, the world's superpowers begin a feverish race to find its cargo, a nuclear submarine control system. And 007, played again by Roger Moore, is thrust into one of his most riveting adventures as he rushes to join the search and prevent global devastation. So the gross for this movie was $194.9 million worldwide on a budget of $28 million. Now that would be $614.2 million in 2021 dollars. Its profit multiplier, well, it made 7 times its budget, and it was the 7th highest grossing movie in North America that year. The winner that year was the debut Indiana Jones movie, Raiders of the Lost Ark. Today, and adjusted for inflation, it is the 16th highest grossing Bond movie of the 25 officially released Eon Productions, just above Sean Connery's James Bond debut, 1962's Dr. No. Ratings-wise, it has a 70% fresh Rotten Tomatoes score. On the IMDb critic Metascore, it is 44 out of 100. Turning to the audience ratings, it's got 64% on Rotten Tomatoes. And on IMDb, the audience rating is 6.7 out of 10. So, a fact here for you. Sheena Easton is the only artist to sing a James Bond theme and appear in the movie's accompanying title sequence. And in summary, Your Eyes Only trades in some of the outlandish Bond staples for a more sober outing, and the result is a satisfying adventure, albeit without some of the bombastic thrills fans may be looking for. Okay, guys, let's talk 1981's For Your Eyes Only. We'll maybe just go around to ask when and where you first seen it. So, Brother Paul, this was a notable one for us, so I'll maybe let you start.
I can just remember briefly, but I believe we saw it in Jersey summer of 81, although I can't really remember that much about it. But
I vividly remember it. So yeah, 1981, Jersey, while we were on holiday, and Dad took us to see it, yeah. So that was my first Bond movie, and your first Bond movie in the cinema. Yeah, and I remember it very, very well.
I just remember really the car.
It. Yes,
the
so
car. That was the
Citroen. Yeah, out of all the things, that's what I remembered as well, the wee Citroen car.
Yeah.
But yeah, I do remember enjoying it, and it was good to see it on the big screen. It was really great seeing Your Eyes Only on the big screen again this year for the first time in, 40 years? That was something. So that's me and Brother Paul. Davie, I'm guessing the first time you seen it would have been TV?
Yep, would have been TV back in the 80s, but it's probably one of the first own films I really sort of sticks in my mind from watching it back in the day. It was on quite a lot. And I remember you wanted to say about product placement, but after this film I started eating pistachio nuts.
Did you really?
Aye. Never had a pistachio nut in my life. Like, Mum, I want some pistachio nuts.
Well, at least it wasn't heroin, I suppose.
Yeah, that's right.
Very cool. And we went to see that at the cinema this year, David, didn't we? I think the Cine World.
Aye, it was good.
That was where I got the notification on my phone, on my watch. Saying the Guns N' Roses show the following night had been cancelled.
That's right, yeah. It was like 10 o'clock the night before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know.
And then we got into the car, November rain was on the radio.
That's like, right.
Yeah, take my piss now.
Couldn't make it up, could you? Couldn't make it up. So, Paul, what about you? Do you remember when you first seen it?
Yeah, it was on the telly. Probably Sunday afternoons at some point. That's when I usually watch the Bond films or so midweek, but it was on the telly.
Okay, and let's maybe kick off talking about the movie with the pre-title sequence, which is a bit of an unusual one. So the pre-title sequence, for those that don't know, it opens with Bond at the graveside of Theresa, Bond's wife, from Her Majesty's Secret Service. So he's at her graveside when the Universal Exports helicopter comes to pick him up because there's some kind of emergency. But little does Bond know that actually it is a bald man in a wheelchair who is not, for legal reasons, Blofeld or anything to do with Spectre, is in control of the helicopter and wants to kill Bond. And then there's some action shenanigans thereafter. What do we think of that scene?
I thought it was really good. They weren't allowed to use Blofeld at all.
They didn't have the rights at that point.
No.
Okay. Kevin McClory had the rights, I think.
Yeah, there was a legal battle. So it was purely coincidental that he wears the same kind of clothes as Blofeld and his bald
neck brace
and a white cap.
Collarless jacket.
Yeah. Purely coincidental. And I think there was a lot of symbolism in the fact that Bond then throws him down the chimney to obviously kill him.
I like to sort of keep your hair on. He's the guy he picked up his wheelchair. He's knocking on the door. He's like, keep your hair on.
Yeah, so it's literally slapping his head.
That's one of the worst things that you've ever seen, though. Then there's a bit when you look, you can see it's like a model on the side.
Do you know?
It's a bald cap. It's so
obvious. Well, do you know? Obviously, it's a stuntman in a bald cap for the stuff in the air. But the guy on the ground is an actor who is bald. And he's been in, at that time, he was in loads of big movies. He was in, he was the guy that played Lobot in The Empire Strikes Back.
Oh, yeah. Is that the guy with the things on his head?
Yep. And yeah. He is also in Superman, I think one or two or both.
Is he in The Shining?
I'm sure he's in Flash Gordon as well. So he was in loads of big movies from that time period, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But yes, so you like it, Paul? What about you, Davey?
Yeah, it's just that's a good reaction scene, isn't it? It doesn't really fit in with the rest of the movie, I don't think. No. It's almost like a wee standalone thing. But the stunt work in it's really good. And it's always good when he gets shut down the chimney at the end.
Yeah. That's a good wee scene. Brother Paul, an agreement?
Not really. I do like the start of it, though, because it's sort of indicating it's going to be a different Roger Moore. It's going to be more serious. You know, like when he's at the graveside and stuff. I like that, but I don't know if it's the music makes me think of, like, you know, when he's in the helicopter, like Cagney and Lacey or something like that. The music, the soundtrack.
Very fine.
Yeah, you know, when he's in the... It's okay, but it's not one of the best ones. But I do like how it was going for that, maybe dark, getting away from everything but the kitchen sink and, you know, the big budget spy Love Me and Moonraker. This one was maybe going back to the roots, you know, just a spy film. So I liked that a bit at the start. But yeah, it's all quite fun, tongue-in-cheek, you know, in the helicopter.
Well, yeah. I think what you're saying there, that the movie is much more of a serious kind of spy thriller, maybe compared to other Roger Moore movies. So for Davey and Paul, how does that play for you after, obviously, the four 70s Moore movies, that you have this change of tone where things are maybe played a bit more straight? How did you find it?
I thought it was better, actually. You know, it was a bit more realistic, maybe. Yeah. It's not as bombastic as, like, Spy You Love Me, or maybe as silly as Moonraker. Yeah. You know, even the gadgets were a bit understated. I think it was a bit tougher. You're not as, a bit airy-fairy as the other Moore films. They're a bit harder. I think it's a really good one, actually. It's a good story, but dark in places. I think that makes it better. I think it's more Bond.
Moore Bond.
Harder, a bit tougher.
Yeah, Davey, you in agreement?
Yeah, no, It's got a good cast, and I like how it's like set in a winter setting. It's got kind of a nice wee twist in it as well, which you don't normally get from these Bond movies. So, it was good.
Yeah, I'm in agreement. I think it was the right choice for them to make after they went very big and very outlandish with Moonraker. To kind of, I think the term they used at the time was to bring Bond back down to earth, and I think they've done it really well with this. And I think Roger Moore himself plays it more straight, and he's actually very good. I think where the parts where he is called to maybe be that little bit more serious, for example, when he's, is it Christatos the who's the assassin?
The guy with the glasses.
Yeah, that's Locke, isn't it? Yeah. Where he throws the badge to Locke when he's in the car on the edge of the cliff, and then kicks him off. That's great stuff.
Yeah,
Roger.
He didn't want to do that.
No, he didn't, did he?
He was forced into it, and I'm glad he did do it as well.
Yeah,
it's all the better for it.
Why did he not want to do it?
I suppose Roger Moore's character, it wasn't about revenge. It wasn't about, you know, like how he didn't like the violent side that maybe Sean Connery would, or, you know, like slapping. What's her name? And Man with Golden Gun.
Maud Adams'
character. Well, he didn't like that side of Bond, but as they were saying, no, but that's what James Bond would do. So he, you know, he'd reluctantly pushed, you know, through the little thing in, and then pushed the car off. But I think it's good that he does that.
I think it's the best part of the film, actually.
Mm-hmm.
You see him legging it up the stairs, and,
mm-hmm.
and then he catches up with him and boots the car off the cliff. It's and good.
Yeah, mm-hmm. that's one of my favourite scenes from it. And I think he also plays the part well when he's down on the beach with Liesl, Countess, who's Pierce Brosnan's first wife.
Yeah.
Which is rather bizarre.
Oh, I've lost me 90. Sounds like you lost your accent as well.
So the Sean Connery school of accents there.
Yeah.
I think it showed like Bond had a bit some morals as well when he wasn't carried on with the young
BB,
the Olympian.
BB.
BB, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a good shout, yeah, yeah. Showing some like moral fiber.
Yeah, he could have been our granddad, yeah.
Yeah, nah, good stuff. So, Brother Paul, you mentioned that in the opening title sequence, you're not a fan of not Tom Conti, but Bill Conti's score, are you?
Yeah, the music's very... I don't know if it's the way it's filmed in the music, but for me, it feels like a TV film, like The Professionals or something. And I like The Professionals, but just... I think it really dated a lot more than a lot of them, actually. Like, for example, Octopussy and A View to Kill, the next one, I actually feel this is dated a lot more than probably even Spy Love Me or Moonraker, just because I think the music, the soundtrack has a big part to play in it as well. And they toned a lot of the effects down. And I think it's Roger Moore's best performance as Bond in the franchise. But it's not one of my favourites, I have to say. Because I quite like the ones that are over the top, big budgets. I kind of like those ones. Yeah. But this one, although it's Roger Moore's best performance, he just looks like an old man.
Okay. So, Davie, kind of focusing in on the soundtrack. Did I not remember you saying you quite liked the soundtrack?
I love the opening theme. That's, I think it's one of my top five Bond themes. Was it Sheena? Is it Sheena Easton? Is it?
Yeah,
Sheena Easton from Paisley.
For Paisley, so we Scottish connection there.
If you hear her now, you'll struggle to hear any Paisley in that accent now.
She doesn't come back to Scotland because she gets booed, doesn't she?
What, walking down the street?
Yeah.
Probably. I like the opening theme and the music throughout is not too bad. It's passable. It's not John Barry, but it's Conti's a good composer in his own right. But I do realise it does have a bit more 80s sound to it, so it's being proper classical.
And I suppose his main ally in this movie is Columbo. if you're looking for a detective with a dodgy eye and a Mac on, you're going to be disappointed, aren't you? So played by Topol. So Paul, what do you think of the character of Columbo as played by Topol?
Yeah, he's quite good too.
Your brother Paul, behave yourself.
sit down.
Oh, sit down.
Topol, I thought he was good, maybe a wee bit over the top at times, but I thought he was a good character.
And Brother Paul, Melina, where does she rank in the pantheon of Bond girls or Bond women?
I think she's really good, actually. She's very beautiful. It almost feels like that's the first big age gap. I could be wrong. Between Bond and a Bond girl, it feels like there is quite a big age gap there. That's when it's really noticeable. Whereas the other ones, you wouldn't really say there's that much of a difference age-wise. But she's good, no? She's got a strong character. She's not just like a bimbo that sometimes, like Mary Goodnight and Man with the Golden Gun we talked about. I think she's really good, actually.
I think she done well in placing that scuba tank so strategically to make it come in handy later. I'll just take this off and leave it here.
You just never know, Davey, when a spare scuba tank under the water can help you out. And the bad guys in this, so there was a few, so obviously Locke and Christatos and Kriegler. What kind of impression did they leave on you, Davey?
Only just
obviously a big one.
not a great one to be sure.
Very memorable.
Who are they again?
The guy with the glasses. I always remember him. But
he's good actually, that guy, yeah.
He is. Didn't a lot to say.
No, I've not got a lot to say in the bad guys in this one.
No. It's actually another really good scene in it where Bond gets captured when he's trying to find out when he goes to, is it Spain? Or Portugal?
Greece.
Spain.
Spain. Yeah, he goes to Greece after that, doesn't he?
But I think it's filmed in Spain. It's supposed to be Greece, I think.
Right.
Or the other way
around. That's good, where Melina obviously puts an arrow in the guy while he dives off the diving board. That's a good scene, that whole thing. Mm-hmm. It's excellent stuff. And there's a real lack of gadgets in this one. In this one, isn't there?
Yeah, I don't know. Was there any gadgets?
Shoelaces.
We're going up the cliff, yeah.
Oh, yeah, the exploding car, and the guy tries to break the lotus.
Yeah, self-destruct.
That was a good gag. Yeah, that was a good gag. But I think that they obviously purposely went with to try and make Bond more self-sufficient and resourceful.
So
I think, shoelaces and all that kind of stuff.
Didn't even get a watch. That's the thing.
I know.
No explosive devices or...
Well, no. Although he does lose his watch at the end when the parrot drops in the water.
Oh, yeah.
When Bond's speaking to Maggie Thatcher.
Was it not some cheap Seiko as well, rather than like a Rolex or a bright light or something like that?
Oh, Mr. Bond?
Where, Mr. Bond? I'm sounding like Blofeld, never mind Maggie Thatcher.
Same thing, really.
Let's talk about, maybe to finish up for your eyes only, let's talk about the then scene, which it, for me, is really, really out of place. Maggie Thatcher. Obviously, somebody playing Maggie Thatcher.
There's a Bond villain.
There's a Bond villain, yeah, I know.
Blofeld Thatcher.
I will close all the coal mines in Britain.
I put 3 million unemployed.
I will privatise everything.
For 1 million.
Milk will be stopped at school.
I will sink the Belgrano.
What do we think of that scene? Because it's just really, really, for me, out of place and really dates the film for really what amounts to a cheap gag, doesn't it? Or am I just...
Yeah, I think it's stupid, to be honest. Just totally pointless. Absolutely pointless. And cringeworthy.
Yeah, no, I like it, doesn't deserve to be in there.
You saying, Brother Paul?
Yeah, I think that's what makes it more like a sort of TV film, because it has that in it. And it just looks quite cheap as well, when obviously it's supposed to be Downing Street, and it's not aged particularly well.
you've got Dennis Thatcher trying to get something at the cupboard in the background, Maggie slapping his hand away.
It made me think of Spit Image.
It was
or something.
Probably a
bottle of
Spit he was looking for.
but that you could imagine that in Spit Image.
Yeah, no. Right, well, let's rank Fear Eyes Only, guys. So, Brother Paul, coming to you first. Is it a top, middle, or lower ranking movie for you in terms of Bond films?
It would be lower ranking.
Lower?
Mm-hmm.
You will get no Christmas card this year. Davie, what about you?
Yeah, I would put it in the middle tier, I would say.
Okay. It's safe.
Yeah.
I would say be Switzerland. What was that?
You can be Switzerland then. Sit in the fence, be in the middle.
I was going to say middle tier, but in the sort of relegation zone of the middle tier.
Well, I say to you all, screw you, it's top tier Bond.
Split up.
Yeah, it's one of my favourites, yeah. Big fan of this one.
Bond hits an all-time high. Roger Moore is Ian Fleming's James Bond 007 in Octopussy. More in his newest and most thrilling of the James Bond adventures, filling the screen with excitement. In the tradition of the great James Bond films, Octopussy has everything: elegant palaces and beautiful women.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
My name's Bond. I believe you have a reservation for me.
We've been expecting you, sir.
I'm Octopussy. And you are James Bond, 007, licensed to kill. Am I to be your target for tonight?
This is Bond at his best, hitting an all-time high in Octopussy.
Step on it!
The Bond that tops them all. Octopussy, racing across the screen with thrills and excitement. Roger Moore in his newest James Bond adventure, hitting an all-time high in Octopussy.
Louis Jourdan, with the exception of some nasties like Dracula, we have an image of you on the screen as rather a charmer, I think, and now you turn up as a real skunk in Octopussy.
Yes, of course. I play, indeed, the villain. But
What's the key to doing that?
I think the key is to try to make villainy as attractive as possible, since James Bond is perfection about what is good and what is right. I have tried to make my villain perfect about what is bad, evil, and wrong, but always with humor, because humor, of course, is the key to the Bond pictures, the key to this evening, and I hope that the audience will laugh with us on the screen.
That's good enough to be the conclusion of most movies, and that's in the middle of this picture. Now, with those two scenes, you get a good sense of what this latest James Bond film is about. It's about action scenes, terrific action scenes, but it's also short a little bit on character. The villains are not memorably bad. They're just stock villains. No one is memorable as that classic villain, Auric Goldfinger. That was a great name and a great character. Still, I enjoyed this Bond more than the last few, and for that reason, I have to credit the action scenes. Some of them are really quite amazing. I love that dicing yo-yo.
I don't know, Gene. I had a real feeling of deja vu. I felt I'd seen this movie again and again and again. All the obligatory scenes. He has dinner with a villain right before he's going to be killed. He goes to bed with the heroine, and then they're separated.
But, Roger, it's supposed to be that way.
The chase scene. And then another thing that bothered me, all through these movies, there's always been this business of the double entendres, the lines of dialogue with two meanings. Never before this movie have they been written so dumbly. You get all kinds of bad laughs from the audience because the dialogue is so inept.
I think you're throwing out the film for just a little bit of dialogue. I think that the Bond film has a very classic structure, and I think this film stays with it. I think if it became a different series, I don't think we'd be as interested in it. In addition, I don't think you can name an action picture that has had such good action scenes as
this
one.
Too much action. I would have liked one less chase scene. I just felt that I had seen all this before.
I had never seen some of this stunt work done before. This is really special.
Well, you just take the train chase that we started the show with. You remember the movie Emperor of the North with Lee Marvin had the same train.
Not as exciting as this. This is exciting action.
The next up is Octopussy from 1983, and again directed by John Glenn. So the plot for this one is, well, James Bond may have met his match in Octopussy, played by Maude Adams, who you'll remember starred in The Man with the Golden Gun previously. So Octopussy is an entrancing beauty involved in a devastating military plot to destroy the Taunt. From the palaces of India to a speeding circus train in Germany and a mid-air battle on the wing of a high-flying jet, only 007 can stop the nightmarish scheme. So the gross for this one, it grossed $183.7 million US dollars worldwide on a budget of $27.5 million. So that's just a slight drop on Fear Eyes Only. It's a 6% drop on Fear Eyes Only. And it would be the gross would be $493.1 million in 2021 dollars. The profit multiplier on this one, it made 7 times its budget, which is on par with Fear Eyes Only. It was the 6th highest grossing movie in North America that year, with Star Wars Episode 6 Return of the Jedi being number 1. Today, and adjusted for inflation, it is the 20th highest grossing Bond movie behind Pierce Brosnan's The World Is Not Enough. So critically, it has a lowly 43% on Rotten Tomatoes, but it does fare better on IMDb. So the critic Metascore on there is 63 out of 100. Audience-wise, it's got a lowly 47%, I should say average, 47% on Rotten Tomatoes, and a better 6.5 out of 10 IMDb audience rating. And a fact for you, his visit to India for this movie prompted Moore to become a UNICEF ambassador. In summary, despite a couple of electrifying action sequences, Octopussy is a formulaic, anachronistic Bond outing. So, did anybody see this at the cinema on original release in 83?
Yep.
Probably not, no.
I don't know if it was the title, Paul, as to why Dad never took us to see this one.
Do you know, I didn't. When you're younger, I just always knew that as a title. It didn't mean anything to me.
No.
It's funny.
Octopussy.
Yeah, I know. Actually, I just remember from the time, and I mean, I was only, 9 years old or something, but I do remember that people were very excited about Sean Connery coming back.
Yeah, never again. Mm-hmm.
And you never really heard from me much about Octopussy.
Yeah, most people wanted to see Never Seen Ever Again, didn't they?
Yeah, that's what I remember.
Did the BBs not go and see it? Or I don't think we did, but yeah, I remember the BBs.
Never Seen Ever Again.
Never Seen Ever Again, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the thing is, Octopussy is the better movie for me.
Yeah, it took more at the box office as well.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so yes, I would have seen this on TV, probably a Saturday night or a bank holiday or something, like most Bond movies, for the first time, and seen it at the cinema for the first time just this year and enjoyed it. Did you see this one, Davie?
Yeah, I've seen it at the cinema this year as well. That was I always thought, I don't know why, I thought I'd missed the very start of it because it had started. I'm like, I've missed this, the start of this, because I always thought the start of it was when they're chasing the clowns through the...
That's just after
the credits. After the I can't believe I missed that, It's one of my favourite Bond movies, actually. I really like this one.
What do you like about it, Davie?
It's got lots of action in it. It's got some good humour in it. The start with where I'm pretending to be the other guy and then getting rumbled, yes. And then
Tora Tora
what a load of balls.
And then the whole thing with the wee mini plate micro light. I think it's really well done. I love the setting, how it's in India. It's not something you normally see in films being set
in
India.
You've been there, haven't you?
Yeah, me and Paul were actually there about 15 years ago. We actually visited some of the sets. Well, not some of the sets, some of the locations, like the White Pass Palace. And
you could see. Did you see Kamal Khan when you were there? Did you pop in for a coffee?
We went on that boat, the big lake. We went on that.
The boat trip
in the lake. Saw the road where they had the tuk-tuk chase.
And like any single, because that's in Udaipur. So any single restaurant you go into, every single one of them's got a telly showing Octopussy, and they'll put it back to start for you if you just go in for your meal. Do you want to put it back? Okay.
So would you say to them then, put back to the bit, I don't want to miss the bit with the egg and the chase at the start.
Well, like the rest where you went to, David, the boys switched it off because it was shutting time. It was like halfway through. So he just walked up to the telly and put it off. He said, whoa, what's going on?
But I like obviously if you visit the sets, it's good how his plane lands in like Agra and then he gets off it and he's in Udaipur. It's like a little bit miles away. That's it's like the moment in you ever seen the Eurovision film where Ferrell is when he's driving down Coburn Street and the next thing he turns a corner, he's at the Hydro. That's what it was like.
That's where it's better. You don't know the geography. It's like, ah, shout of it, doesn't it?
It's like mine's CNN during the COP26 in Glasgow. The boy says, we're here live in Glasgow, so Edinburgh Castle is behind them.
That's right. He goes, it's the same thing, isn't it?
It's really not. Yeah, so big fan of Octopussy, Davie.
Yeah.
Okay. You feel the same, Paul?
I do, yes. I think it's a very enjoyable film. As David said, a lot of action, that micro light flying through the big hangar, and then just getting through the doors as they're closing, like Star Wars type thing. And it's a good story as well. It's a very enjoyable film.
The one thing that does stick out about it is when he does the old Tarzan thing through the trees, and it's a like, come on.
an in-joke too far, that one. And
if they removed that sound effect, it would have been perfect, but
it would have been alright, wouldn't it? Yeah, no, agreed. So let's kind of stay with the story. Now, Brother Paul, is it just me that finds it confusing in parts?
Not really, no. It's just you. What do you find confusing about it? Is it because it goes from like so many different locations?
No, I think it's the whole Fabergé eggs and the forgery of the kind of jewellery and such like from Russia, which can be a bit confusing.
I think it's a good film as well. I think it's one of the ones that's always maligned. It was always people made. I mean, all the time. It's Roger's safari outfit always gets a mention, but it's so famous. Like, it's always, yeah, I like it. I think it's quite tongue in cheek. It's one of the kind of most tongue in cheek ones. Obviously, when he's dressed as a clown at the end, I'm from the British Secret Service. There's a bomb. You know, it's.
But of course you are.
Yeah, but I like it, and I think the baddie is good. He's brilliant, Kamal Khan.
Yeah, I like him. He's a lot of people good. Weren't impressed by him, but yeah, I think
he's good.
Oh, I like him.
So do I? Yeah, I like him.
He's crushing the dice.
Oh, yeah. This is one of those Bond movies for a long time that really kind of passed me by. But yeah, it's a really enjoyable film. It's got some really good lines in it, including one scene which is one of my favourite all-time Bond scenes, where he's playing Kamal Khan while he's in India at the hotel. It's like, oh, you need to win, Mr. Bond. Oh, well, I'll then use player's privilege. I'll use your lucky dice. Rolls it.
Yeah, <that's
right. laughs> Rolls it, doesn't even look at it. Oh, fancy that. Double sixes. <You
know>? Yeah.
Spend it quickly, Mr. Bond.
And he goes, actually, I prefer it in cash. That money saves him from getting stabbed, that money.
It does, hard currency.
It's good that he took the cash.
I like how he switches the Fabergé egg at Sotheby's as well.
That is really good. That is really quite clever. Can I have a look? He's like that.
Like M's face. It's like, I've got the original here. And M, M. Oh my God. Yeah. So what do we think about the villains in this one? So yes, we've already mentioned Kamal Khan, played by Lewis Jordan. Let's talk Orlov, Stephen Berkoff.
He's brilliant.
What do we think of Orlov?
A bit over the top, shall we say? Especially when he's, when he's given the plan to destroy Europe, and he gets all overexcited about it, and other parts of the film as well. I mean, he's okay as a baddie, I suppose, but yeah. They get a bit over the top at times.
What about the twins? I thought they were really good.
Yeah, they were.
Oh, yes, aye.
They were good.
Yeah.
Quite scary, actually. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the twins, aye.
Especially the first time you see them chasing the other agent and basically cabbage on. It's a bit scary.
Did anyone for a minute ever think that was Roger Moore? When they first watched it, when they were a baron, that actually was getting chased. I just knifed Roger in the back.
That's just you, Davie.
I thought it looked like him.
Would have been for a very quick film.
Yeah, I know. Well, here's
but the action stuff that you do on top of the trains and that. It's
oh, yeah.
Again, it's great stunt work.
And at the plane as well in the end, you know, the fight.
Yep.
Just yeah, that's the brilliant.
Plane. Oh. Yeah. I think that's mental, the plane stuff, the crawling on the wings and everything.
Yeah. aye.
Some cojones to do that, isn't it? Oh.
Do not flick them with the aerial.
Yeah.
That's right, yeah. That's how you get some
of them. But fabulous stunts. And the train stuff, as you say. Martin Grace, the stuntman, got really seriously hurt doing that. Because I think the train went onto a bit they hadn't scouted. And there was, I think,
a pillar or something
was kind of jutting out, so the train wouldn't hit it. But if you were hanging off the side, so I think obviously the train was going at some speed, he's hanging on the side, bang.
He stayed hung on.
That's what saved him. That he managed to hold on till the train stopped. Otherwise, he would have been under the wheels.
Yeah, because he was Roger's stunt double. Yeah.
So. Not good. Here's a great fact for you. Do you know at the beginning of the movie, the pre-title sequence, Bond meets up with his contact. It's meant to be Cuba, presumably. And he meets the young woman.
And yeah, we've talked about this, haven't we? Yes.
Yeah, and the Jeep, you know. Which again, another great moment, you know, where the kind of captain's looking at the young girl, giving her the eye as the Jeep goes by.
Oh, that's the guy from the Young Ones, isn't it? Neil from the Young Ones.
Is it?
The guy in the Jeep, yeah. Is it? He's one of the guys, yeah.
I didn't know that. And then obviously he goes by and it's Bond sitting there. But did you know that girl? bearing in mind, Roger Moore at this point would be, what, 55?
55.
That girl, who he was then going to meet in Miami, 16.
Yes.
Well, the girl on the Jeep?
Yeah.
She was 16.
What? No.
Yes, 16. She was.
Mm-hmm. 16 no. years old. Yeah.
Bloody hell.
So, let that sink in that Roger Moore is about 40 years older than her.
Roger's three times like older than her.
Isn't that mental? I know. And we also had in that we had a new M. We still had our same Money Penny. And we had a new assistant called Penelope Smallbone. So what do we think about the allies? So of course we had them, we had Octopussy herself, played by the returning Maud Adams. So Brother Paul,
she's good. Octopussy character's good, Maud Adams, and there's a good chemistry with her and Roger because they're similar in age, they're close in age, so there's quite a good chemistry as opposed to him and the 16-year-old girl at the start. Although we didn't know that at the time, of course. But I think she's really good. I like VJ as well, the tennis player. He's really good. That's the saddest bit in the film when he comes back and sees he's been killed. He's a sacrificial lamb. And I really like his, he's quite funny as well. I really like... Do you like that character? What about you?
Yeah, I like Maud Adams. She's she's a really good Bond girl. She's got quite a strong part, but she's I always fancied her when I was wee. She was like my ultimate when I was wee. Was a band.
Did you want one of those beds that are like the shape of an octopus as well? Can I get that for Christmas, Mum?
Yeah. he was having muddy thoughts about Maud. I had John Barry coming back to soundtrack this one, and the theme by Rita Coolidge, All Time High, which was John Barry and lyrics by Tim Rice. So. Let me come to you, Paul. What did you think of the soundtrack and the main theme?
I think the main theme is a really good one. It's I think it sounds like a Bond theme. As soon as you hear it, you probably think, yeah, that could be a Bond theme, even if you didn't know the film at all. I liked how it kept recurring throughout the film. As for the rest of the soundtrack, the threat with the bomb, the missile. You know, that sort of music, the do-do-do-do-do, whatever.
Yeah.
That's really good. So, yeah, I think it's a strong soundtrack, as you'd expect, from John Barry. It's one of the classic themes as well.
Brother Paul, I remember you buying the CD of this, and I remember one of the novel things at the time. It was like, ooh, there's CD-ROM content on it.
Enhanced, that's right.
How exciting.
Yeah, because I wanted to get, because you couldn't, at that point, they were really hard to get. And when you did get them, they were really expensive. It was like £16-17. Because I remember getting the Living Daylights like that as well. But it's almost like a return to form, because after For Your Eyes Only, which sounds, very dated, this, it was quite good, actually. It felt more like Bond. And the theme itself, it's probably one of the ones that wasn't the most well-known ones as well, but in maybe the last 20 odd years, I think it's becoming sort of seen as a Bond classic. A big part to the film Ted that helped raise the profile of it as well. But it's a great song, actually. She's got a really good voice, even though it wasn't a big hit at the time. But I think it's really stood well, stood the test of time.
Yeah, so I think it's a really good soundtrack. There's a lot of the James Bond theme in it, and I think that was maybe deliberate because it was going up against Never Say Never Again.
So they can use it, yeah.
Mm. That's right. So just put it in there to remind them this is the official Bond. And yeah, as you say, Paul, it wasn't really one of the most highly regarded theme tunes, but it's a really good song. I like it. You a big fan as well, Davie?
Yeah, that's again one of my. I would put that in my top five Bond songs. It's like a strong female voice, hits the high notes at the right times. I love the use of like the saxophone at the start of it, and like repeating the theme throughout the film as well. It's really well used by John Barry. Just in the quiet moments and things like that, you see the theme recurring. It's great. I love it.
Do you like good sax, Davie?
I love good sax.
Sax at the start
with mod.
Sax in the city. Right, so let's go to the ranking. So, Brother Paul, are you going with top, middle, or lower tier for Octopussy?
I'll say middle.
Middle? I'm going middle as well. Davie?
Top.
Top. Okay. Paul?
I'll say middle.
Middle. Okay, dokie. Thank you for that, gents.
A secret ambition.
I propose to end the domination of Silicon Valley. Project Main Strike.
A secret plan.
For which each of you will pay me $100 million.
And a secret weapon.
We're not sure about her. Name's Mayday.
Someone will take care of you.
Oh, you'll see to that personally, will you?
There's only one man who can stop them.
Bond. James Bond.
And I'm Dick Tracy and you're still under arrest.
In the world of high adventure, the highest number is still 007. James Bond 007 with Tanya Roberts, Grace Jones, and Christopher Walken as James Bond finally met his match. Find out this summer in A View to a Kill. Title song performed by Duran Duran.
Middle of Bedlam, that's where we are. No, we're in the Amberley Chalkpits Museum in Sussex, which is on the screen will not be there at all. As you can see behind, it's nothing to do with the chalkpit. This is it's a gold mine, presumably in San Francisco or near San Francisco. And the mines are about to be blown up to flood Silicon Valley. because Zarin, Christopher Walken, is going to take over the world's production of microchips.
Every part is a challenge, and this is certainly different from anything I've ever done. It's exciting to be in a Bond movie.
Action, Chris! Action!
Boy, I remember the first time I saw James Bond. The movie was From Russia with Love, and I was about 14 years old. I thought that was the toughest, coolest, sexiest movie I'd ever seen. Well, that kind of James Bond movie is a thing of the past, I'm afraid. A View to a Kill is pretty typical of the recent 007 adventures. More PG than R, and sort of a cartoon. The highlights, of course, are those incredible stunt sequences, such as this one in Paris. Along with those great stunts come some other less exciting features. A villain who doesn't have much charisma, played by Christopher Walken. A leading lady who's positively wimpy, is played by Tanya Roberts. And a villainess who's strictly a matter of taste, Grace Jones. Frankly, I was disappointed in A View to a Kill. First off, it goes on forever, more than 2 hours. Then there's Roger Moore, who's looking older than the world's most dashing secret agent ought to. I don't find this new style Bond film very sexy or very cool either. It's just an excuse for some big action scenes with a lot of boring filler in between. Those stunt sequences are sensational, and they rate a 10. I just wish the rest of the film was that good, but I really can't rate it any more than a 6. I'm Malton, Leonard Malton, for Entertainment Tonight.
And on to our final movie, 1985's A View to a Kill, directed by John Glenn. So the plot for this one, so after recovering a microchip from the body of a deceased colleague in Russia, British secret agent James Bond, again played by Roger Moore, discovers that the technology has the potential for sinister applications. Investigating further, Bond is led to Max Zorin, played by Christopher Walken, the head of Zorin Industries. Soon, Agent 007 faces off against the villainous Zorin and his tough Amazonian bodyguard, Mayday, played by Grace Jones, who are scheming to cause massive destruction that will eliminate the competition. So the gross in this one, it grossed $152.4 million worldwide on a budget of $30 million. So that's a drop of 17% compared to the previous movie, Octopussy. So that would be $380.1 million in 2021 dollars. So the profit multiplier on this one, it made 5 times its budget, which is down on the previous 2 installments. It was the 11th highest grossing movie in North America that year, the winner being the classic Back to the Future. Today, and adjusted for inflation, it is the 24th highest grossing Bond movie, ahead of the lowest, which is Timothy Dalton's License to Kill. So, looking to the ratings, so critically, this has a low 38% critic Rotten Tomatoes score. And on IMDb, the critic Metascore is 40 out of 100. And audience-wise, it doesn't really fare all that much better on Rotten Tomatoes, so the audience score there is also 40%. It's a little bit better, though, on IMDb, with it being 6.3 out of 10. And in fact, it was said that Roger Moore knew it was time to finish playing Bond when he found out that the mother of his love interest in the movie, played by Tanya Roberts, was younger than him. And in summary, absurd even by Bond standards, A View to a Kill is weighted down by campy jokes and a noticeable lack of energy. Let's move on to our final movie of this two-part set of episodes, and it's 1985's A View to a Kill, Roger Moore's Swan Song. So let's find out where we all first seen it. So Paul, brother Paul, where did you first see Octopussy? Where did you first see A View to a Kill?
In the Dominion in 1985, Dominion Cinema in Edinburgh. And yeah, really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I remember that. I think that was the first time we'd been taken to the Dominion. Just remember, oh, this looks very fancy. You know, the Dominion being the white building. Just looked very, very fancy. Yeah, Art Deco. I just remember being very impressed by the exterior of the cinema and really enjoying the movie. Paul, what about you?
I have a feeling I saw this in the cinema, although I'm not entirely sure. If not, then I definitely it was. Like, once again, on the telly on Sunday afternoon or midweek.
Just start a 15, no? Was this a 15 when
it
was in the cinema?
No, it was an 18.
No, that was a License to Kill.
PG.
There's a kill in it, yeah. I suppose.
You the same, Davie? Just TV?
Well, believe it or not, this is probably one of the last Bond films I've ever actually seen. So I watched it for the first time about, I would say, at the start of this year. Right. I've never seen it before. And I watched it not long after, well, maybe about 6 months after when it was in the cinema. And I honestly wondered why it's taken me so long to see that, because I think it's a great movie. I really enjoyed it. We went in with expectation, they were saying, oh, he looks old as anything, blah, 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 blah. Went, oh, okay, and then the rest of the watch went, no, this is brilliant.
Yeah. So, goodness, Davie, what makes A View to a Kill a really enjoyable movie for you?
I love Christopher Walken as an actor, and having him playing a Bond baddie is just a great choice. He plays the part so well in it. There's lots of like good set pieces in it. I like the fact that it's almost like a precursor to your Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk taking over the world with their megalomania. So I don't think they really had that kind of person back in those days, but now we've certainly got quite a lot of them. Multi-billionaires,
yeah,
that just think they can, well, basically own the world.
So that's for you the one of the strongest elements, Paul. What's the weakest element of the movie, in your opinion?
I think it's an okay Bond film, but I do think old Roger's showing his age. It does look a bit decrepit, and yeah, it's an okay story, and I thought Christopher Walken was really good, really good baddie. I just think, you know, it's, you can sort of tell it was the end for Roger. You could tell it was his last film, and yeah, it was okay, but I didn't think it set Heather on fire. I think in some scenes, the stunt double.
Yeah.
Like that scene where he's chasing Mayday through Paris and the car he's driving is basically cabbage.
Suddenly got blonde hair.
He gets the long blonde hair. And you could,
Or he's jumping on top of the...
It's a stuntman.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was okay, but it was actually on the telly a couple of weeks ago, wasn't it? It was on ITV4, I think, last week or the week before.
Yeah.
And yeah, it was. I don't think it was anything to write home about, unfortunately.
Okay, I think the interesting fact, we're talking ages again here, that I think Roger knew it was time to hang up the holster, hang up the gun, when he found out that the mother of his leading lady in the movie was younger than him.
That's right. See, that I knew it was time to give up when the Bond girl's mother was younger than me.
Yeah. So, Brother Paul, what did you think of Roger Moore's rapport with Patrick McNee? Was playing?
Yeah, it was really good. Yeah, I think it really worked well, those two. They just... Because obviously they've worked together and things in the past, but I just think it worked. It was just quite funny as well, because obviously... He was quite, I don't know if the Tibbet character was part of the aristocracy or something, and he's like making out, he's like his slave basically, and he's sort of, you know. But interestingly enough, when he goes in and Jenny Flex, she's the woman that's in The Last Crusade.
Right.
You know, the woman that's in it. But no, I think it's good. And it's quite sinister, that bit where Tibbet goes into the car wash and then Grace Jones that's quite scary, that, but you just see the shadow but I always loved the idea how if you were in your car and it went and it ended up going in the water, you could just take the air from the tires. I always thought that's really handy to remember. Know that. To keep breathing, I'll just take the air out of the tires.
That's actually a really good moment. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Bond's ingenuity, yeah. Mm-hmm. So, Davie, what are the best action scenes in this movie for you?
It's obviously like the stuff with the horse racing is quite good. Where they keep adjusting all the obstacles after Christopher Walken's been over it. It's like suddenly lower or higher.
He goes like that, presses it.
I thought that was quite good. I do like the bit in the Zeppelin at the end. I thought that was quite good.
Yeah.
So it harks back to the like Hindenburg and all that. That's the German. Is he supposedly of German origin? Was he Max Zorin? What was the story? Was it he was cloned or something? Or what was it?
It was part of a Nazi experiment.
Experiment, yeah.
For breeding out so-called undesirables, make them the perfect human. But it went slightly awry and turned out to be a bit crazy.
I thought it was good that they used the old Zeppelin, kind of like the Hindenburg, all kind of tied in. And the fight on the sand, the Golden Gate Bridge is one of the most iconic. Well, they've used quite a lot of iconics. Got the Eiffel Tower and like fighting the Eiffel Tower. Nah, it's got a lot of good action scenes, I think.
And the bit
at
the
start. The Eiffel Tower scene, I thought it was the best one.
It was.
The Eiffel Tower chase.
Yeah, I think there was the true story that the day they were going, or I might be remembering this wrong, but the day they were meant to do it, they were told they couldn't for some reason. I think two of the stunt guys who were due to do the jump went up and did it illegally anyway, and I think they got... They got sacked, and they said, enjoyed doing it, but it was stupid to never got to work on a Bond movie ever again because of that.
I think they did it in like the early hours of the morning or something like that.
Yeah.
Did they use it in the film?
No.
No.
No. So, but I agree. I think that stuff in Paris with Eiffel Tower is great stuff, and the bit on the Golden Gate Bridge is excellent, and the fighting at the top of that. It's really good stuff.
You're a taxi cab when you need one.
So let's maybe go to the leading lady. So the character of Stacey Sutton. So for you, Paul, where does she rank in the in terms of the Bond ladies?
To be honest, I don't remember that well. I remember more Grace Jones more, actually. but for what I do remember, I think she was pretty good, actually. I think she was quite a strong character. I forgot she was a scientist or something, wasn't she?
She was measuring...
She was a geologist or something like that.
Geologist, that's what she was,
yeah.
What was the actress's name again? She just passed away not that long ago.
Yeah, last year.
Last year or two.
Tanya Roberts.
Sunday Roberts.
And Tanya Roberts. Tanya Roberts. So, you in agreement, Brother Paul? Good Bond leading lady?
I think she's one of the worst.
I agree.
Her acting, and it's just so bad, and there's no chemistry with her and Roger, and obviously it's sad because she's not long passed away, but she's probably one of the worst Bond girls in it. But I really like Grace Jones. I have to say, I thought she was really good in it. It captured that time.
Yeah, I remember watching it with my gran once, and that scene where Bond's fighting Mayday. Mm-hmm. My gran said, who's the other guy? Grace Jones.
I made the, to be fair, I quite like the media character. She's quite a good evil villainess. I think she played the part well. She had, I suppose she had a redemption at the end.
That's right, yeah.
Well, I thought she was good as well, actually. I thought it was a good character.
It was almost like that part was made for her, really, wasn't it? You know, you can't imagine anybody else doing that. Not like the physicality of it.
Right. I thought that's what she was doing. The other, the bottom lassie, she didn't really stick out as being one of the, like, having a big part to playing it or a memorable bottom lassies. Yeah. Not for me, anyway.
So let's maybe just jump to the theme song. So, I know this is one of my favourite James Bond themes by Duran Duran. I think it's a great song. We're all in agreement it's one of the best.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
It's very good.
It's okay. I wouldn't say it's one of the best. That's okay.
I think it's amazing.
What do you not like?
See, when I try and think about it, I always start singing the Aha song to myself. Wait, no, that's a different film.
You're one film ahead.
What do you not like about it, Paul?
I don't mind it. I don't think it's one of the best. That's the thing. It's
not a Duran Duran fan, no.
I like Duran Duran, yeah. It's an okay song, but it's not in the same class as Spy Love Me and Goldfinger.
Okay. Well, gents.
Sound dubious.
Yeah. Oh, you're wrong, but it's okay.
Yeah, just as well the video's off, eh?
Yeah, it's a pity you can't see how many fingers I'm holding up right now.
You're counting to two right now.
Yeah, I started with one, then I went to two, yes.
No, it's three, then four.
I never made three or four or five.
No, the other hand.
So let's go around then. So, Brother Paul, where are you ranking of you to kill? Top, middle, or lower tier?
Top tier.
Top tier for you, right? Davie?
Yeah, I'm going to say top.
Oof. Paul?
Lower tier.
I'm with you, Paul. Lower tier for me as well. I still enjoy it, but it's I think Roger's past his prime here, and I think things feel a little bit tired. But hey-ho. So let's go now round each of you so you can give us your overall ranking of the seven Roger Moore Bond movies. So I'm going to come to you first, Brother Paul. So what's your kind of least favourite up to your favourite?
So what I've got is there's seven films. So it's seventh place, Man with the Golden Gun.
Mm-hmm.
It's six, For Your Eyes Only. 5, Octopussy. 4, A View to a Kill. 3, The Spy Who Loved Me. 2, Live and Let Die. And 1, Moonraker.
Ooh, okay. Interesting. Davey?
Right, so I would say number 7 would be Moonraker. Number 6 would be For Your Eyes Only. Then I would say A View to a Kill, The Spy Who Loved Me, Live and Let Die. And I would go 2nd would be Octopussy, and my favourite would be Man with the Golden Gun.
Ooh, interesting.
The exact opposite of mine, isn't it? That's what's good about these things.
Ooh.
Yeah, completely the opposite. Yeah. Okay, Paul, what about you?
So 7, be A View to a Kill. 6, probably Moonraker. 5, For Your Eyes Only. 4, Man with the Golden Gun. 3, Octopussy. to, this is a very close one actually, Live and Let Die, and then top would be A Spiral Up Me. But that's a very close one because they're both excellent films.
Cool, thanks for that. For me, I would probably go with The Man with the Golden Gun at 7, A View to a Kill at 6, Octopussy at 5, Moonraker at 4, Live and Let Die at 3, Fear Eyes Only at 2, and at number 1, The Spy Who Loved Me. So, yeah, that's quite interesting. Everybody's kind of quite different views on the on their favourites there, but that's as Brother Paul says, that's a part of the fun of talking about these movies. So, as we wind up, guys, how would you best summarise Roger Moore's reign as Bond, Davie?
I would go out on a limb and say he is my favourite Bond.
Okay, thanks. Paul?
I would say he's just different. I think he brought his own interpretation to the character.
Yeah.
It's quite different to the books and Connery and Craig.
Yeah.
But I think he started off really well with Live and Let Die, and then The Spiral of Me, and things, I'd say, probably gradually got worse as the films went on. But I think he seems to be a thoroughly decent guy. And I know he wasn't fond of violence. So
yeah.
I think he's just different to the others, but it's good in his own way.
Yeah, thanks for that, Paul. Brother Paul?
I think he did really well, actually, in the films. You know, he didn't try and copy Sean Connery. He made it his own. I still think Sean Connery is the best Bond. However, I'd say the Roger Moore films I probably prefer than the Sean Connery ones. Maybe it's just because that was my era, maybe, I don't know. But no, he did very good.
I think the action was better in the Roger Moore ones than in the Sean Connery ones for me.
Yeah, I think when you kind of get to the 70s Bonds and the Roger Moore ones, the stunts are just next level, aren't they? Whether it's the ski jump off the cliff and Spy Love Me, the falling out of a plane with a parachute, Moonraker, getting dragged along the sea in Fear Eyes Only, the Eiffel Tower, or the fight at the Golden Gate Bridge, or the kind of the small, microlight plane, and the pre-title of Octopussy. I mean, the action is fantastic. No getting away from it.
I was just going to say, even the rock climbing in 4 years only, that's brilliant.
Big time. And I think, for me, I'll always think of Roger Moore as the charming Bond and the funny Bond. Definitely the funniest. I think lines with other actors just would not be as funny. They always had that kind of nudge, nudge, wink, wink with the audience, which was good. So, gents, thank you for joining me and Paul again to conclude.
Yeah, thank you.
This look at Sir Roger's Bond movies.
No problem.
Great. We've put Sir Roger out to pasture and kept the British end up whilst doing it. Before we go, a reminder that you can follow the podcast on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter and TikTok, and look out for our next episode coming next month in December, which focuses in on the Terminator movies. So, until then, keep trimming. One.
Oh, that's a sound day.
Coming soon.
I am in a very large...
This episode's coming out on Halloween, is it?
Yeah, next Monday. Yeah.
Once upon a time. I'm going deeper down the well. I can't get out.
Help me, Bond. Help me.
Help me, Jimmy. Jimmy
Bond. Help me, Jimmy Bond.
All I wanted was a sweet distraction for an hour or two. I never intended to do the things we've done. Funny how it always goes in love when you don't look.
Yeah.